Good evening. Thank you for the kind introduction. Thank you for having me. I would like to talk about tonight how architecture has such a profound impact on all of our daily lives in so many different aspects, and how a more systemic approach towards architectural design might help us to develop more holistic design solutions which cater to the various requirements that architectural design is facing today. Let us start here, in your home, in our home, in everyone's home. Home is sort of like the nucleus of everyone's life. It's the place where we come to rest, to recreate, to gain strength for the next day. It's the cozy place where all of us have been growing up, where we raise our families, where we raise our kids, where we meet our friends. But for so many of us, home is so much more than just a shelter. It's the thing which a lot of people refer to in the architectural scene as the third skin. A lot of people have the desire for home to complement their lifestyle, to express their inner beliefs, and to be part of their way to see the world. Huge industries have been growing around this aspect of home. Now, the problem is, if home is not so much subject to individual ambitions, but is subject to top-down city planning and developers and free market forces, home might look like this. What you see here is the serial copy of the same typology over and over, spread out on a piece of land like you would spread out peanut butter on your sandwich for breakfast. What you see here is the serial production of an individual dream, which is a contradiction in itself, of course. What we're looking at here is not only an aesthetic problem, but also a functional one and an environmental one. In terms of functionality, this kind of settlement fails to provide spaces for our society to communicate, to gather, and to exchange thoughts. In terms of environment, this is probably the most inefficient typology of a human settlement. It consumes so much land, relies heavily on personal transport, and requires a lot of resources. However, the human settlement, highly densified human agglomerations, have been proven to be the one single model to manage our society in the best possible way. Rapid urbanization is what we can observe today, which oftentimes lead to unprecedented density in built-up areas. More often than not, looking like this. Again, non-articulated buildings copied next to each other, unindividual. Maybe these models might cater to the need for housing or might be an efficient model when it comes to the economic aspect of it. But surely they do not succeed in catering to what humans are looking for in a home: coziness, individuality, high-quality spaces to meet, talk, and exchange thoughts. What most of us are looking for in a city is the quality that can be observed here: a vibrant urban fabric with a combination of built-up area and open spaces densely interwoven. A mix and an interplay of built-up mass and open space creates this vibrant urban feel that a lot of us are looking for, ideally with a human scale, as you can see on the left, which is the Piazza Navona in Rome, or on the right, which is the Plaza Mayor in Madrid. Under the influence of rapid urbanization, oftentimes also our urban cities look like this, again failing to provide those spaces that we're looking for. Now, when talking about cities, we should not forget that cities are not only kind of like the organizational framework that our societies rely on, but also are the institutions that help us to constitute societies. In a way, if you like, cities constitute societies. They provide the spaces for us to exchange thoughts, come to conclusions, exchange, communicate, and gather as a society. In that sense, again, cities constitute society, and at the same time are the expression of the societal model that we live in. Different types of societies will bring about different cities. On a more practical level, cities also provide the infrastructure that all of us rely on to manage our everyday lives. Cities provide streets, tracks, train stations, airports, municipal buildings integrated within the urban fabric. With all of these building activities, what we are doing as humans is we create an artificial environment, which is a player against the natural environment. All of this building activity is, of course, in heavy exchange with that natural environment. We consume a lot of the resources when we build, and we have a profound impact on the climate. This can be observed if we look at the energy consumption of the building sector, which makes up 40%, about 40% of the energy consumption of humans in total. To summarize all the things that I've been shown to you, I would like to introduce the term of designed environments. All those different building activities, your home, your workplace, cities, urban designs, open spaces, could be submerged under the term of a designed environment. It's a non-natural environment, an artificial environment, which, and that is something we should never forget, we are free to choose what it looks like. It actually is all of your choice what our environment looks like. It might be designed by one single architect, but still you are the customer of an apartment or you're the tenant of an apartment. It's up to market forces and up to all of you what the environment looks like to a certain extent. The other key aspect is that these designed environments are in constant exchange with the natural environment. For a long time, architecture used to look at this as a single direction road. We were only looking at how the natural environment would influence our buildings and think about soil orientation, stuff like that. Lately, we have come to think that it is also our designed environment which have a profound impact on the natural environment. There is a constant exchange going back and forth. The starting point of my architectural career was this question: what if? What if we were to develop design models which would allow us to integrate all of those various requirements into design? What if we were able to design buildings not in a linear manner, but to design them integrative and use all of those forces that I have been showing and all of those aspects to generate the form in a sort of like evolutionary process, so that the building itself is generated under the influence of forces and requirements rather than first putting up a building out of some sort of like magic creative process and then learning later how it performs? There is a very good example for this sort of like design process. It can be found in nature. It's called evolution. What you see here are the key players in the game of nature. You see plants, animals, bacteria, fungi, and all of those species are exposed to the climate, which you see on the left-hand side. The temperature, solar activities, radiations, and the atmosphere. And there is a complex back and forth between the climate and all of those species. Now, we could start looking at architecture in the very same way. What you see on the right-hand side is my abstract representation of what a building could be like. The idea is to read a building as a system which is composed of different subsystems. There's the spatial system with certain proportions, neighboring conditions, and so on. There's a structural system, an MEP system, a facade system, a material system. At the moment, all of those systems are very often still designed in a linear way. First, the spatial system will be designed, then the structural one, then the MEP one, and lastly, the facade one. What if we were to think of design models which are capable of integrating all of these different systems, have those associatively connected, and have them talk to each other to come up with a smart, interconnected system? And then, of course, this system, composed of subsystems, is not a standalone system. It's integrated in surrounding systems. That is the environmental system, the spatial system, the infrastructural system, but also non-physical ones, like the socio-political system or the economic one. There is a constant exchange and impact of all of those surrounding systems onto our building system and vice versa. What I would like to propose is to start reading buildings as systems, and also use generative design models which are capable of using all of these different parameters to drive the generation of geometry, to come up with more holistic design models which integrate all of those different influences. I'd like to share four examples of my work. The first one touches on an issue that I've been raising in my thesis, which is the rapid urbanization. This is a project we have currently under construction in China. It's a mixed-use development of 600,000 square meters, two twin towers, both 280 meters tall. What you can see here in this image is that we moved all the building to the outer perimeter of the plot to form a calm and peaceful pocket in the center of the building plot. Now, in large cities in China, land is one of the most expensive things, and it is given by the government. So moving the buildings to the outer perimeter was a bold move, which took about 3 meetings and 3 travels to China to convince everyone that this is the right thing to do, because usually cities are designed for cars and infrastructure, not so much for people. What we did here is we threw the buildings at the outer perimeter of the plot, just as you would throw stones into water. And those buildings would sort of like create ripples, and all of those ripples would swing with each other and generate one holistic landscape, which is the seamless continuation of the buildings itself. The quality can best be seen in these two diagrams. What you see on the left-hand side is the traffic diagram. You see that all of the traffic is on the outside of the plot. All of the drop-offs, car park access points, all of the dirt and the noise of the traffic stays outside. What you see on the right-hand side with the green lines is the pedestrian traffic. We create this calm pocket, like a lake sitting in between mountaintops. Now, for the building design itself, we applied that quasi-evolutionary design process that I was talking about. What you can see here is the generation of the final tower design scheme that we came up with. As you can see on the right-hand side, the starting point have been 5 different species of massing models for the high-rise. Then we started evaluating those different tower models against certain criteria: efficiency of core to usable space, structure, facade performance, and from an urban point of view. And then we started creating crossbreeds of these different types to, in this kind of like evolutionary design process, finally end up with the final tower design scheme. The result is what you see here on the left-hand side, a design which is capable of providing different views and different sites from every spot of the city. So it is a highly efficient geometrical model for a tower, yet it looks different from every spot from the city. At the same time, the facade, which gives the tower its iconic appearance, is not only a decorative one, but it reduces the heat gain on the facade by 40%. It is what I would call a multi-performative object. It performs on multiple levels at the same time. That's what the construction site looks like, where you can see how our project stands against this kind of like urbanization that I've been mentioning earlier, the copy of the same high-rise typology, which fails to be iconographic and provide identification or quality of life. Second project I'd like to show was done for the government of the Federal Republic of Germany for a new institution by the United Nations called the Green Climate Fund. It was part of a pitch, country of Germany pitching to host that institution. The idea here was to derive a language from the River Rhine, because that building is located exactly on the banks of the River Rhine. At the same time, create an energy plus building and create a new type of vibrant workspace with high quality workspaces. As you can see, the office spaces are grouped around 3 internal atria. And these atria are not only a representational feature of the building, but they provide highly communicative spaces for workers to exchange and to fertilize cross-communication in between the work units. Research has shown that the efficiency of an office group can be raised significantly if there is informal communication throughout the building. At the same time, based on generative design principles, the building incorporates certain sustainable features such as an LG reactor on the north-facing side and PV cells on the backside of the building. Again, what you can see here is what I would call kind of like a performance-based shape, because it's driven by performance, but then it's a highly articulated shape. Last project is this one, which even takes that idea of integrating multiple tasks at the same time and being multi-performative one step further. This was done for a competition in Los Angeles. This is a series of rafts, which are free to move on the ocean, and are capable of purifying salt water. It's actually a mobile desalination unit, if you like. is composed of all of those elements which you see here. At the bottom, we have floaters, which allow the pavilion to float. Then we have a raft, which provides a gathering and lounge area. And then on top, we have a conduit system and desalination tanks, which make it a highly functional building, which integrates high-quality spaces with the functionality of desalination. Water being the most scarce resource of our time, especially in California and Los Angeles, this building manages to combine high-quality spaces, communicating sustainability issues outside of the river, and providing fresh water which can be enjoyed right on those rafts. This would be a freshwater bar. Part of the water which is purified can be consumed here right away while learning about human impact on nature and while learning about sustainability and water scarcity. A good part of the water will be streamed into the local Santa Monica water consumption. Last project I'd like to show, which sort of like summarizes all the things that I've been saying, is located where I live in Berlin. What you see here is an image of Karl Marx Allee in Berlin, an urban design model which clearly has not been made for humans, but has been made for cars, and maybe more so for tanks and military parades. It's a total inhuman proportion. It's impossible to cross these roads without having a red light. Now, all of this city model relies on the integration of cars into our cities. What if we would need less cars because cars would be smart? What if we would need less traffic because we have less transport, because food production is localized, energy production is localized? What if we could use a big part of this huge stretch in the inner city and turn it into a high-quality space, which does this? So, of course, this one is meant to trigger thought. It's not an actual proposal, but the idea here is to show the potential that would be at our fingertips once we start reducing the space that we waste for cars and for inefficient infrastructure. What you see here is self-driving cars with detection system. At the right-hand side, you see how we gain new space to install a new type of infrastructure, which integrates spaces for meeting, for urban gardening, and for gathering into the city, which have not been there before. As you see, we kept the old buildings, but have given those an upgrade. Could also say that we sort of like live in the era of upgrade in Europe, since a lot of area is already built up, but we upgraded those with local food production, local energy production, minimizing the need for transport and maximizing the good quality in the inner city space, because we turned this from a purely infrastructural area into a human-centered space to stay in. Thank you.